IVM.
This is Audio Gyan, and I am your host, Kedar Nimkar. Welcome to a deep dive into the minds of luminaries from the Indian creative world. Today we have Ganesh Devi with us on Audio Gyan. Ganesh sir is a thinker, cultural activist, institution builder, linguist, and a literary critic, and a former professor of English who undertook the project of surveying Indian languages in 2010. If I have to speak about his body of work, I guess it will be more than the episode with him. You can find all the notes about and all the links about his work on ganeshdevi.in and relevant links in the show notes. Welcome, Ganesh sir. I'm so honored to have you on the show. Can't thank you enough for giving your time.
Well, I'm pleased to be here. Thank you for inviting me on this episode.
Yeah, great. So I'm like, just a quick disclaimer, I'm not an expert, so pardon for any naive questions if I ask, but it's an honest attempt to document some of your thoughts. And I've given the talk name as Design of Languages because Audio Gyan has been talking about design to a certain extent. And I thought everything is designed. So how about languages will also have its own semantics and own structure, and they're designed. And we'll explore that in the conversation.
Well, that's very fascinating. Thank you for thinking of something out of the box.
Thank you. So, sir, I would like to start with the most basic question. Like, how do you define a language? And then how do you define a dialect? Is there any traditional definition for it, or has it evolved over time?
There are two or three ways of defining language. And depending on which way you look at language, the definition will change. For instance, those who study languages as material, they define it as a system of science. But those who look at it as a human means invented for communication define it as a method of intersubjectivity, that is, connecting consciousness of a person with the consciousness of another person. Then there are people who look at language as a body and as a corpus. And they define it as a corpus which has some embedded rules of behavior, norms of behavior, which we normally call grammar. So the grammarians define language as a thing with a grammar. Linguists, structural linguists, look at language as a system of signs. And these are arbitrarily made, created signs, they say. And those who are interested in the study of consciousness, the phenomenology, they look at language as a system of, as a carrier of significance. They do not think about which sign, but what is the significance, what is the meaning, what is the core of what you say, not how you say it, not if you follow grammar or not. So these are three different approaches to defining language, and therefore, language does not have a single or a simple definition. Then, if you are actively engaged in the field of environmental studies, and if you think of humans as a part of a larger chain of beings, both animal beings and non-animal plant beings, then the definition of language is given as a higher stage of evolution. It is believed that other animals also will get into the language stage when they evolve sufficiently and their brain structures get as complicated, as complex as the human brain is. The human brain works with the help of 85 billion neurons. But the brain of an ant does not have similar kind of complexity. However, ants have rudimentary form of language. And that is why when you try to stop an ant in its way, then it turns around. And when the obstacle is removed, it still manages to go back to its original path and meet the other ants which walk in a queue or some kind of formation. That formation is ordered by one of the ants, let's call it the queen ant, like the honeybees, the queen bee commands them, and the bees also understand language, but not our kind of language. Ours is a uniquely designed product.
It's so fascinating because when you say this, is it that the queen commands something and then the ant exactly understands what it is and not doesn't decipher based on his or her experiences? And that's the difference which humans have. Is that what you're pointing to?
Yes. I mean, the various kinds of ants have a great understanding of photonic signals. When they see obstruction in the path of light, they understand the nature of the obstruction. So the ants, they also use chemical signals, but that takes a greater energy for them because they have to produce those chemicals. And therefore, they do not use, like the case of dogs, for instance, when dogs lose their path, they go on smelling, sniffing, and then manage to return home. That's through sense of smell. That is a chemical communication. But in the case of ants, while they're capable of chemical communication, chemically induced communication, triggered communication, they depend more on the use of light and shadows to find their path, to find their safe path. But their language ends there. They are not able to communicate about yesterday and tomorrow, the past and the future. Humans have invented symbols which can actually signify the past and the future.
Mm-hmm. And you also spoke about the grammatical or the technical aspect of it being a bit arbitrary. Can you tell us more about it? And also, is this a pattern predominantly in the Oriental philosophy versus the Western? Is there any that access to the understanding?
Well, the grammarians look at the placement of these symbols in the structure of a sentence. Does the subject come first or the object come first? To market I go or I go to the market. And then they decide which is proper, which kind of syntax, which kind of arrangement of symbols will work within the given range of words available and the meaning that those words are supposed to reflect. To make it easy, let me remind you of this puzzle which we used to be asked as children about. There is one tiger and one bakri and one haystack and one boat to carry it to the other. And children used to find out which is the safest way of getting there without getting the sheep being killed, without the grass being it consumed, and the tiger not being killed. And so the grammarians look at the available word stock and their maneuvering ability within the entire outer framework of those meaning, collective stock of meaning of those words. And within that, they decide which set of rules would work for this set of words in such a way that these words serve the maximum utility for the users of those words. That is the creation of grammar. And I am quite amazed that the idea that a language has a grammar, every language has its own grammar. There is no universal grammar, though there is a certain universal grammar, which is the minimum common, but every language has its unique features. And people in ancient times, say about 3,000 years before our time, in Greece, in Rome, Rome had still not developed then, but in the Latin world, and in our own part of the world, in Pali, Prakrut, Sanskrit, thought of grammar as a useful way of teaching children the maximum utilization of words in the minimum space. And that is the idea of grammar is not for giving marks in the matric examination. That's the worst form of learning or understanding grammar. Grammar is exactly like what the notation is for a singer. I mean, with seven notes in the Hindustani classical music, you can produce such a range of voice maneuvering. the gymnastic of voice, to be precise. And if one learns those notes, then it becomes easier to train your throat in producing those notes, those tunes. So grammar is not external to a language. It is a good, careful observation of a given language and its use, its usage in the middle of people who use a language. Just as mathematics can be music to mathematicians, grammar can be quite musical to linguists who study grammar. I'm not one of those because I never studied linguistics in a systematic way. All of this, whatever little I know about languages, is all picked up along the way out of my observations and my work with different language groups. So I'm more closer to people who think of language as a tool of the consciousness, human consciousness, for connecting with the consciousness of other human beings, other animals in the human species.
Sure. So, but when you say grammar, we also have something called as Praman Bhasha. I wanted to just poke around that. And like, who decides this grammar? Is it organically evolving? Are there bodies like these who, and probably right from the Greek period to few of the Rishi Munis, like how does it translate? And then like the next question is like, what is a Praman Bhasha? Because okay. I'm particularly curious. I had heard one interesting podcast where they said it's a political concept, Praman Bhasha. So I wanted to understand that bit as well.
Yeah, let's look at it this way. When a human child is born, from the age of 8 months to the age of 18 months, a great transformation takes place in the brain of that child. Because up to the age of 3.5 or 4, the brain of the child develops very, very rapidly. And that is one reason why children need longer hours of sleep to heal the flow of chemicals required for a child. The work that a child does inside its brain is much more than an IIT graduate does inside the IIT lab or classroom. It's a very laborious process. Now, in those 10 to 12 months, the child learns that its body and the body of its mother are separate. They are not one and the same. Up to the age of 8 months, the child thinks that the mother's body is extension of its body. Now, this separation enables the child to think of I and non-I, self and non-self, me and the rest of the world, the ego and the non-ego. Now, this is bound to happen to every human child. Actually, the reason why children are not supposed to see a mirror before the 9th month is this, that, the notion of the self, Sigmund Freud would have called the narcissistic, arena structure, would be hugely disturbed if a child is shown its image in the mirror, because the image is seen by the child as another. From the age of 8 months to the 18th month, the child learns to look at its image in the mirror as another person and learns to look at itself through the eyes of the image.
Wow.
This is fascinating. A lot of research is done on this. Now, why I mentioned this is, before paper arrived in the world, before books were produced, before humans made cities, they still had this ability, because humans have been using language for the last 70,000 years. And so I imagine that humans would be having this ability to distinguish between the self and the other for over the last 65,000 years. Now, that being the case, in ancient history, that is, I'm going back to, let's say, 45,000 years before our time, when the huge migrations took place from Africa to the rest of the world. And this out of Africa, what anthropologists call the modern man, out of Africa, this modern man decided to settle in different places. But the migrations did not stop well until yesterday. They're still continuing.
Yeah.
And so every time a new entity comes in an already settled area, the settled people start looking at this new one as another, as an other, an outsider. Mm-hmm. One of the markers of identity of the other are that person's language.
Wow.
When from Gujarat, I go to Bombay and start speaking Marathi or Hindi, immediately they say, oh, Gujarati aavya chho. Or from Yorkshire, people go to London, immediately the person is marked out and is shown as a dialect, user of a dialect.
Mm.
Now, this particular identification of the others, making language as the identity, is the basis of the general impression that some people use language differently than others. The ones who are described as users of language differently are normally the outsiders. Those who arrived there late. Like, you know, some terrible politicians say that if you eat biryani, we know that's a threatening thing. So it is the same with language. Otherwise, there is nothing like standard language anywhere in the world. Because every time we speak a sentence or use a word, every time its meaning is different. We cannot use, just as philosophers say that you cannot stand in the same river twice, because a lot of water, that water has already got you standing last minute. Similarly, the meaning of every word keeps changing every microsecond within the body of a given language. And so scientifically speaking, no standard language. But the standard is created sociologically, not linguistically. And this sociological idea of the self and the other is imposed on the use of language of people. For instance, in Maharashtra, if you were, let's say, a non-Brahminical, non-upper class, upper caste, then your use of language would be objected to in the classroom by teachers.
Mm.
And there, It is the caste and the class bias which is being articulated rather than a proper linguistic analysis as such. That is, when I studied in Leeds, most of the British landladies used to refuse giving rooms on rent to Asian students. And they said, no, their food smells strange. But it was not the smell of the food. It was really this sociological bias of somebody being from an inferior society or inferior race. Or, you know. So it is for the same reason that if there is a smell of camphor, kapur, and suddenly we say, oh, namaste, you know, sir, like we join our hands and we think this is something sacred and so on.
Mm.
So it is the sociological bias.
Wow, that's so...
No language is standard, no language is non-standard. All language is equally standard because all language does precisely the same work, that is, of communicating meaning. Words are a transport system. They are conveyor belts and they carry certain payload. They carry certain quantum of meaning. Sometimes even not using words can convey meaning.
Yeah, in para. So I wanted, that was the next question. That, like, I have read about this four types of communication. I mean, we are digressing from languages to communication, but it's somehow connected also. We have these four, right? Para, Paschanti, Vaikhari, and Madhyama. I have not said in the correct order, but we have. So, like, the earlier point which you mentioned, that those who look languages from a syntax point of view or grammar point of view also consider this as a utility to communicate. But those who look from a linguistic standpoint, do they classify languages in these four categories?
Yeah, I'll answer that. You know, you mentioned this Para, Paschanti,
Vaikhari, and Madhyama.
That theory comes from a thinker of 7th century, I believe, called Anandavardhana. Hmm. He has written a book called Dhvanyalok. That is, he's describing the cosmos of Dhvani, Dhvani ka lok, the cosmos of sound. And his curiosity was how sound actually creates meaning. Mm. His basic question was, does meaning pre-exist sound, which then sound carries it from X to Y spot, X to Y person? Or is it created in the act of caring, in the gesture of caring? And his questions came from an earlier thinker called Bhartrhari, who existed 200 years before him. Let me mention Bhartrhari first, and then I go to this Para, Paschanti, because without that, we won't get the full sense of what it is all about. Bhartrhari said that if there is a stream with flowing water, and you hold an object above the stream, there will be a reflection that you can see. But if you take the object away, you take the object off, will the reflection remain? The answer is no. Correct. So Bhartrhari said, language is like that river, but you hold a concept above it and you see the reflection of that concept. A concept such as, you know, an idea. By concept, I mean an idea, such as, let's say, house is a concept, a shirt is a concept, car is a concept.
Apple, yeah.
Apple is the most standard concept in physics. So Bhartrhari was saying that the concepts by themselves do not have any meaning. Language creates meaning temporarily as an illusion of meaning, because the reflection is an illusion. So Bhartrhari was proposing the theory of meaning as momentary illusion. Outside that river stream, those concepts, like whatever you hold that apple, the apple has no meaning as such. So is the meaning in the apple or in the river? That was the next question. And Bhartrhari said, it is neither in the concept nor in the language, but meaning suddenly bursts out in the mind of the listener. And he called it sphota. This theory is sphota. Now, in response to that sudden outburst of meaning, when there's a conjecture of concept and the available language facility, in response to that, Anandvardhana said that that theory of Bhartrhari is wrong. I don't agree with it. The real theory is, I mean, this is what Anandvardhana was proposing, that there is meaning, but it is nascent. We cannot have access to it. It is there. It is like Parmeshwar. It is para. It is beyond our cognition. But it certainly is there. He has no proof for that. He has no evidence for that. But he has an argument. And the argument is that because there is para, you can actually see inside your mind the form of a word. That you know, Pashyanti is the one which is seen. So the form of the word is seen in your mind. I mean, now as I am speaking to you, there is a sentence or words in your mind. You are about to speak, but inside your mind you can see. And Vaikari is when that form of the meaning seen inside your word is given the company of sound. It becomes Vaikari. And then what is born is tokens in the cosmos of Dhvani, in Dhvani Loka, Dhvanya Loka. They become words for us. So it is a debate between two philosophers, both of whom are taking recourse to abstractions beyond the ordinary sphere of language and its users. And it is because Bhartrhari was fighting a battle with Buddhism and Anandvardhana was fighting a battle with Bhartrhari's linguistic theory called Vaisheshika.
Okay. Wow, that's amazing to hear. And I would like to just continue on those front, but that's, I understand that's more on the spiritual front as well. So just coming back to the practical world and the real world, I have like a few more questions.
Before we jump next, let's take a quick break. We'll be right back.
Hey everybody, it's been a great week on the IVM Podcast Network. On Cyrus Says, Cyrus is joined by music composer and YouTuber Yashraj Mukherjee. They talk about his journey, viral music, and a whole lot more. On Advertising is Dead, Varun speaks to Ankit Vyas from Oxfam India about how the increased privatization of education over the years has led to severe inequality. On The Wire Talks, Siddharth is joined by Professor Gil Verniers. They discuss his years of research on politics in UP, especially in the run-up to the elections. On Tere Mere Raaste with Keshav, hear all about the Haveli in which great Urdu poet Ghalib lived. On the Talarate Kannada podcast, Pawan is joined by Pratilipi Kannada's Akshay Balagere to talk about how Indian language writing and reading is changing in the digital era. Do follow us on social media. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and LinkedIn. And remember, if you're enjoying this show or any of other shows for that matter, please do tell a friend. And finally, we'd like to thank our sponsors this week, Cred, Bank of Baroda, Quarter, CoinSwitch Kuber, Slay Coffee, Intel, Kotak Mahindra Bank, and Oxfam India. Thank you so much for making this possible.
Okay, welcome back to the show.
In your TEDx talk, you mentioned about language doesn't die. it can only be killed. So I wanted you to just explain with some one or two examples which will help us understand this better.
See, every word takes birth after a lot of labor of the mind by people who use a given language. I mean, the words don't drop down upon us like rains come. Even for the rains to get generated, there's a lot of work that nature has to do.
Yeah.
Humans labor inside their minds to think of precise description of things, because every word is a naming game. It is like giving name to something. Or as Shakespeare said, you know, to give local habitation to an airy nothing. So we name things like mountain, river, hill, book, horse, etc., etc. These are so sturdy that these tokens are, these signs are accepted by everybody in the community. There is a tacit understanding that the word joy means happiness. And unless it is used with greatest irony, oh, what, you know, what terrible thing, you know, some joy to see. But because so much labor has gone into it, because the entire community has accepted it, when some individuals stop using certain words, other individuals still continue to use those words. And in that sense, language cannot die so long as that community is alive. But for a variety of reasons, if the community has to do, is forced to make language migration for the, let's say, for livelihood, just as today coastal people have moved inland and therefore they have moved out of their languages. The Kharwa language spoken by the, you know, people in southern Gujarat on the coastal area, no longer find Kharwa people. And about 30 years back, there were 50 lakh speakers. Today, there are hardly 500 left. So because the livelihood practice of this community is disturbed, their language will die. So languages do not die. Languages by themselves do not die. But by disturbing the people who speak a given language, a language can be killed systematically. There have been systematic attempts at killing languages in history all along. To give you a slightly different example, in Karnataka, where I am just now, the women were expected to speak Tulu, and men were expected to speak Kannada. So naturally, the Tulu language slowly started going down, and Kannada developed. Because men had more money, more power, they were in a position of domination, dominant position. So languages can be killed, they do not die by themselves. There is, and by the way, language is not like an animal, it's not like a tiger or an elephant which will take birth, grow and then die. Language is not an organic system, I mean, it's not a life system. It is a system of signs created. And therefore, it does not have to go through this cycle of birth, growth, and death. That's a wrong idea we impose on language, because we use a metaphor for languages called the mother. We think it's mother tongue language. For India, we often use the feminine pronoun for language, she. Marathi sangli hai, Gujarati sari che, Hindi achi hai. So language has no gender. Language is not a person. Language is a system of signs. That's all about it.
But you also mentioned about the carrying capacity of a language also. So what does that mean? Because
words are born within a certain context, geographical, cultural, social, political context, technological context. Now, if these words are made to serve purposes beyond their capacity, then those words start developing aberrations. They undergo changes. This English language was, it took birth around, let's say, the 10th or 11th century. For the first two centuries, it was barely surviving because French was the national language of England at that time. It was being taught in schools because the French ruled England. And so from the 15th century, English starts becoming, from being a seed, a plant and a sapling. And then mighty writers came along, Spencer, Shakespeare, Milton, Chaucer, they made it a very sturdy language. The Bible was translated into English, and so it acquired a theological dimension also. Scientists contributed a lot to making English a language of knowledge. Now, this language going out to, let's say, Papua New Guinea, to Congo, or to Ghana, the context there are very different. The plants are different, the animals are different, the birds are different. So that language starts failing, but in the process, it acquires new features. If English is used in India to describe how parrots speak, then persons say, yeah, parrot is parroting what parrots say, things like that. Mm-hmm. Now, because there are mythical parakeets in the Greek mythology, the British people have not seen them. They exist in, these are divine parrots, parrots in heaven, but the British did not see. The English language is not sufficiently competent to describe the complete behavior of, or the color, more punky sadi. The British won't be able to say what is now. Will they say peacock color? I mean, they'll say some indigo, blue, deep blue, light blue, high blue, thick blue, etc., etc. When these new realities confront a language, beyond its capacity to describe that reality, that language starts undergoing changes in such a way that after a while, after 100 or 200, 300 years, the same language used in another area becomes mutually unintelligible to people who speak its original language. And that is why today, what an Irishman says in English is not intelligible to what a New Zealander says in English. Mm. They have to make great effort for understanding. You know, if I go to see a Hindi movie, I can shut my eyes and listen to the movie and understand it. When I go to see a German movie, a French movie, or English movie, I have to keep my eyes, I have to listen with my eyes also. Mm-hmm. Because I make a sense of the gestures, the movements, the facial expressions, and so on, and then derive complete meaning. So that is what happens to an Irish person listening to a New Zealander. And if you tune into different TV channels, let's say from NDTV to Al Jazeera to BBC and CNN, you'll see that what the CNN fellow is speaking is not so easily intelligible to what the Al Jazeera person is saying. Mm-hmm. So the great shades, varieties develop, and then language falls apart. That's what I was saying.
Yeah, and not understanding or not intelligible is not at a very superficial level of the accent or the dialect, but it's much more deeper than that with the actual meaning also, because the contexts are different. Is that correct?
The context.
Yeah.
I mean, when some lady from Maharashtra says, this is my 16th Monday fast. I think Chola Somvar, the person from Africa or US will not understand what that lady is saying.
Correct.
All the baggage that the Chola Somvar, I am going to offer prayers to the real, the truth, the true Narayan, Satya Narayan Puja. They will not understand. What is so? I mean, I'm not trying to ridicule these situations, because when people speak like this, they're real people speaking real language. But because that language has run out of its ability to carry further payload of meaning, that starts failing.
Mm-hmm. So I'll deep dive into this payload bit. But one more example, which I've heard in one other podcast, was in India, maybe the concept of having personal space is not that prevalent, or was not that previously. And with the new generation, mala maji zaga paije, it doesn't sound exactly the way you say, give me my space, right? So same example. Now they're trying to translate, but the space as a concept, or the personal freedom, not freedom, but yeah, freedom space is interchangeably used, but it's still not very clear when you borrow these words from other language.
You're right. But let me add something interesting.
Yeah, please.
When I studied in England, in those days, we often traveled in trains and buses and heard nobody say anything at all to anybody else. It was a social norm not to speak in trains, but just to be reading your day's newspaper or doing nothing at all. In India, if you travel in a train, then it's difficult to stop people from talking. Things have changed now. Now they're more glued to the, you know, their mobile phone and WhatsApp. But there was a time when they used to talk. And it is because India has many languages. And even when you are in a public space, you can switch over to a language not known to the public and known only to yourself and communicate. But in England, that facility did not exist because everybody understood English language. And so there was no personal space in public places in a monolingual country. But in a multilingual country, there are many hidden private spaces for everybody. And so the idea of space, personal space in public arena is quite different that we have and that they have. And it's the same in the private arena.
In fact, I think in the private arena, we also have churchi bhasha, searchi bhasha. Like you add certain conjuncts or syllables after every word. It codifies it, but it's quite interesting.
So in a language which in people who are monolingual by and large, they develop what we call slang or different registers. And slang is not only gali galoj. Slang is not dirty language. Slang is an attempt to invent private space for a certain age group, certain professional group, and so on. So we find that children who go to a certain English medium school, even in India, they have their code words because they want those words not to be understood by the teachers. So humans have been very inventive with languages, and they will remain inventive with languages for another maybe 200 to 300 years. After that, humans are going to move out of the language phase and move on to another system of science.
Since you mentioned about the carrying capacity, I've also read about there are languages who thrive because they're accommodative. For example, Hindi. Like Hindi was never like a... Hindi is a culmination of the Bhojpuri and like a lot of other languages, right? So what is that then? Because it sounds very counterintuitive that if languages thrive, I mean, how can they diminish if they're accommodative?
See, it's a brilliant question. Thank you for asking it. And what I will say might unsettle many people. But I am going to say it.
Yeah, please.
Hoping for compassion from my listeners. And it is, Hindi is more an arrangement than a language. Let me explain what I'm saying.
Sure.
During the 19th century, at Calcutta, the British set up a printing press for the first time. And for the first time, they appointed this, the printing press was at St. Fort William's. It was supposed to produce books for English young people who came to India to govern. And these were normally in their mid-20s. They landed in India. So they had to be given primers in different Indian languages to teach them languages of the people they would be ruling. So among the primers produced, one was in Bangla, another in Marathi, third in Tamil, one was in Hindi. Now, till then, this is the first decade of the 19th century, 220 years before our time. Till then, no speaker of what we call Hindi today would identify herself or himself as Hindi speaker. You mentioned that there was Audi, there was Bhojpuri, there was Khadi Boli. Khadi Boli was probably the more dominant form of Hindi. And that Khadi Boli had a good deal of alienation from the Persian language. That was its peculiarity. So it was anti-Persian in its bias. And because Persian was the national language throughout the 17th century and the 18th century in this country, it was spoken by everybody. Our Shivaji Maharaj used to speak Persian very fluently. He could write letters in Persian. And so Hindi, this book was published by a man, the officer was called Lalluji Lal. He was a learned man. He was appointed by the British. And Lalluji produced a book called Hindi. So what was in the book came to be known as Hindi. This name is mentioned once prior to this by Al-Biruni, a traveler, and he called it Hindavi. But by which he meant it is a set of languages spoken in India. though he used that term. Mm. Now, today, in our census, every 10 years it is carried out. And I have been watching the census from 1961. And I see how the population of Hindi shown in the census as growing. In 1961, it was shown as 34% of the entire Indian population. At that time, the population was 53 crores. So this 36%. Then the 34%. Then it was shown as 36. After 10 years, 38, 39, 41. Now 43%. And total speakers of Hindi are shown as 52 crores and some lakhs. But the interesting part of this is, it has listed within Hindi 65 other languages as Hindi. Bhojpuri is listed within Hindi, and Bhojpuri speakers, people who claim Bhojpuri as their mother tongue, their number is 5 crore, 5 lakh in 2011 census. But Bhojpuri is pushed into it. Rajasthan is also included. Kumauni of Uttarakhand is included. Our Paura language from Maharashtra is included in Hindi. While Marathi speakers count Paura as part of Marathi, Hindi speakers count Paura as... So it is an arrangement. Hindi has survived as an arrangement, and it's a beautiful arrangement. That arrangement accommodates many languages. And those languages which have no reservation in belonging to the description, those languages which do not feel hurt by the description, Hindi, are all included in the arrangement called Hindi. Now, you know, to your question, Hindi is the fastest growing language because it is a new language arrangement. And it is a fascinating experiment. I'm sure what I say might hurt some people because people's sentiments are attached to a language as it's their mother tongue. But I don't mean to offend anybody. To some extent, Marathi is also a kind of an arrangement, though Marathi has a certain firmer linguistic basis as a system of grammar. Hindi mein kuch bhi bola to chalta hai, kyunki uski shuruaat kahi bhi ho sakti hai, vakya ka ant. It's a beautiful arrangement. It is extremely humanitarian. It is accommodative. It does not look down upon people who use Hindi wrongly. Isliye, bilkul Persian biased Hindi se संस्कृताइज हिंदी तक और भोजपुरी हिंदी से लेके हमारा आंध्र प्रदेश का जो हिंदी था इन ए मूवी लाइक अंकुर फॉर इंस्टेंस दैट शबाना आजमी स्पोक एंड शी स्पोक इट ब्यूटिफुली इट वुड बी म्यूचुअली अनइंटेलिजिबल टू द कुमाऊनी स्पीकर इन उत्तराखंड बट कुमाऊनी इज एक्सेप्टेड एज हिंदी दखनीज ऑफ आंध्र प्रदेश इज एक्सेप्टेड एज हिंदी उर्दू ऑफ औरंगाबाद इज एक्सेप्टेड एज हिंदी So it is a wonderful arrangement. Once we are clear about it, then one's admiration for the real Hindi can be properly organized. Admiration for the arrangement can also be differently and properly organized. Thank you.
Awesome, awesome. Sir, just to conclude one thing, what keeps you awake at night today? And I mean, this is pointing towards if anybody wants to get into this or understand language or get into survey or any like tip direction which you would like to tell the future of India as a linguist.
Diversity is precious. We must preserve that diversity because our respect for diversity reflects our respect for human beings and also for nature. And we are not apart from nature. We are a part of nature. I go to bed and fall asleep the very next second. It has been a lifelong habit. I never, when I wake up, then I don't try to go back to sleep. I just, you know, approach the next day or whether it is the middle of the night or early morning, whatever. So there is one worry that I have, and that is I am forgetting, I have started forgetting more words per minute than I ever did before. And my worry would not have been a worry because such a behavior called amnesia has a medical treatment. There is a therapy for that. But my fear is compounded by the fact that I'm not alone, that practically every human animal, every human being has started forgetting language. And while people speak more, they speak fewer words. I mean, you think of the English language, for instance. English is spoken as mother tongue by nearly 180 crores all over the world, or even a larger number. But they speak far fewer words than were spoken when English was the language of, let's say, about 20 crores or 10 crores. It's the same with Hindi. Hindi is now spoken by a larger number of persons, but they speak less Hindi. And some years back, I was talking to my Adivasi friends, and I was talking to them about the future and how their horizons of expectations must be lifted, I said. I was using their language, but I used the word kshitij. Ikshapla kshitij var unsavala paije. And then somehow I should ask them whether they knew what kshitij means. And when I asked them, they said, we don't know what the word means. The word kshitij exists in Gujarati. It exists in Marathi. It exists in Sanskrit, Hindi. And therefore, those Adivasi languages which were part of my discourse at that day were bound to have a word like that. But if humans forget a word like kshitij, then languages are endangered. And when humans forget a word like truth, and they think that another word called post-truth has identical meaning, then languages are endangered.
Beautiful, beautiful. On that note, we'll conclude this. Thanks a lot, sir. I can't thank you enough. This is like, I'm actually short of words. Cool. Thanks a lot.
Thanks for your wonderful questions. Do let me have this clip of whatever you call it. Yes. Whenever you want to send it out. Thank you.
Okay. And that's it from today's Gyan session. For show notes and more Gyan, visit audiogyan.com. If you like this podcast, please don't forget to check our other interesting podcast on IVM Network. You can listen to us on IVM Podcast app, ivmpodcast.com, or any of your favorite podcasting apps. To stay tuned, follow us on Twitter and Instagram at IVM Podcast. And if you wish to connect with me, I am at Audiogyan Moments on Instagram. Until then, take care.
If you're a cricket fan, check out Edges and Sledges, India's favourite cricket podcast.
The podcast focuses on Indian cricket, the IPL, and has a ton of banter both on and off the field.
We talk about the week's biggest cricket stories with current and ex-international cricketers, coaches, or sometimes just between us.
And it's hosted by me, DJ.
Me, Varun.
And me, Ashwin.
New episodes release every week.
You can catch us on the IVM Podcasts website, app,
or wherever you get your podcasts from.
Check out the Edges and Sledges Cricket Podcast.
Do you like true crime stories? Do you like to learn about the people behind some horrible, awful crimes? More specifically, women that may have committed these crimes. Actually, Indian criminals that are women? Then we'd like to welcome you to our podcast, Misconduct. My name is Raghavi. And I am Nisha. We cover themes like murder, dacoity, drug trafficking, financial fraud, kidnapping, and many more. You can catch us every Wednesday on the IVM Podcast Network or wherever you get your podcast.